Our next session will be on the case presentation. I would welcome Dr. Chandrasekhar for the conducting the session. Thank you.
This is case presentation from the fellowship students who are studying now at CRICR.
Good afternoon. I think we have reaching the last session. The last session always happens to be our case experience presented by our current fellow students. I think I call upon Dr. Bharat Raj to present the first case.
Good afternoon, everyone. Today, case presentation, an elderly lady from Bangalore who is a homemaker. She came with complaints of multiple joint pain since 4 years, puffiness of fingers since 20 days, and complaints of pain and redness of skin over the right hand and forearm since 20 days. So she was apparently normal 4 years back. Initially, she developed joint pains which involved both large and smaller joints. It was symmetric and there was a swelling and early morning stiffness of more than 30 minutes. And there were no deformities of the joints. And she complained of puffiness of finger since 20 days, which is associated with paleness of the finger digits, pain involving the fingertips, and she also complained of small ulceration which is present over the tip of the right index finger, which didn't have any discharge or bleeding, and there were no aggravating or relieving factors for the pain, and there was no history of any bluish discoloration of the fingertips. Also, she complained of pain and redness of skin over the right hand and forearm, and the pain used to aggravate on touching the skin and movement of the hands. So she didn't have any history of dry mouth, fever, and other skin rashes, oral ulcers, and no muscle weakness or breathing discomfort. And there is no eye symptoms like dry eyes or vision disturbances. There is no history of alopecia or weight loss, and no history suggestive of involvement of any other systems like respiratory, cardiovascular, or neurological symptoms. So past and family history were nothing significant, and treatment she have received a combination of methotrexate and hydroxychloroquine since past 3 years, and on and off she has taken a course of oral corticosteroids. So to summarize, elderly lady with a history of inflammatory joint pains of 4 years. Now she presented with puffiness and pain of the fingers with paleness of the digits and a small ulceration which was since 20 days. So the diagnosis
I request any one of you to dissect the case. Dr. Harish.
So a case of an elderly lady with polyarthritis. Inflammatory polyarthritis with early morning stiffness. History is very much suggestive of a probably a rheumatoid arthritis in the initial.
One diagnosis is rheumatoid arthritis. How do you account for her swollen, puffy fingers?
Rheumatoid vasculitis.
With a rheumatoid.
With a rheumatoid vasculitis. Because digital ulcers.
There was no ulcers, as he puts it.
Small ulcers.
There was a small ulcer.
Tip and then color changes.
Right.
All these things.
So any other clues? Any of my our senior. Other possibilities. Systemic sclerosis. Probably till now was diagnosed as rheumatoid arthritis. Okay.
Considering the only 20 days history with no skin thickening, it is difficult to tell it is systemic sclerosis. Only 20 days history. With 20 days history, I would like to consider the infection as a first cause. Then probably any other connective tissue disease later.
So I think in a nutshell, I think one possibility is a rheumatoid with a developing vasculitis. And one possibility, it could be a misdiagnosis of a scleroderma. The other possibility is to still keep the rheumatoid as a background with an infection. Or you want the entire episode to be as an infection. Because it's a 4-year history of polyarthritis with a worsening sudden development of a new symptoms. Anything else? Anybody else? Dr. Sunita? Yeah, please.
And the diabetes also, the main been there because intermittent steroid?
She was on intermittent steroids, but I think that she, so one possibility you consider diabetes with a pre-existing rheumatoid. Please go ahead.
So one diagnosis might be RA with overlap scleroderma and like RA with overlap dermatomyositis, RA with vasculitis, and infections might be possible like viral, like Epstein-Barr virus, chikungunya, dengue, mycobacterium, mycoplasma infections, also syphilis infection rarely, and other puffiness might be due to sickle cell dactylitis, psoriatic arthritis with dactylitis, sarcoidosis, and other possibilities, paraneoplasia. So on general physical examination, she was moderately bed and arrest, and she was cooperative to examination, and the vitals were stable, and there was no pala rictus, clubbing stenosis, lymph nodopathy or edema, and right ulnar nerve was palpable. So this is the picture showing puffiness of finger digits, and also the edema or the medial aspect of the right hand, and a small ulceration, but it is not covered in the right index finger. Also, erythematous changes were rotated in the left knuckle area. On systemic examination, was apparently normal, and lab reports counts were normal, but altered NL ratio. And high ESR CRP levels, and RNA was positive 2+, and RA factor was high, that is 189, and hepatitis and hepatitis B and C markers were negative. Liver function and renal functions were normal, and the DNA profile which we did is negative, and nerve conduction test showed that there was a right ulnar motor sensory axonal and demyelinating neuropathy.
I think with this, any revision in the diagnosis? One possibility is Hansen's. Any specific point on which you would like to think about it?
Nerve thickness.
Anyone else? Any other competing diagnosis? Could it be still scleroderma? Or any point against that? Yes, and also asymmetric as you put it. But what you cannot explain is the nerve conduction, I mean, NCV showing a neuronal defect. Any other? She has ANA positive 2+, rheumatoid factor is also strongly positive, ESR is persistently raised, and she has been treated for rheumatoid arthritis for quite some time. Almost three to 4 years.
So giant cell arthritis did you
consider? GCA no. GCA don't.
Think of SLE in this case. Vasculating process, neuritis.
Yes, yeah. That possibility is that. It could be a part and parcel of a lupus with vasculitis. But profile is not very much suggestive of that. And also complements was, I think we are not. We had done, it was normal.
Complements are normal.
No.
Sjogren syndrome can cause peripheral neuropathy, but yes. Not neuropathy in the hands, but commonly it causes peripheral neuropathy. So it could be RA with scleroderma and Sjogren's.
Sjogren's.
Porphyria can cause.
Porphyrias overlapping, but it's too elderly for a porphyrias to present for the first time. Am I right?
Paraneoplasia.
Paraneoplastic syndrome is something which you have to always worry in this kind of setting. When, as it is said that there is some sort of a background chronic disease, what's been diagnosed as rheumatoid arthritis, and she's developing some sort of an acute symptom from past couple of weeks. So now we need to seriously look what are we handling about that. One possibility is mixed connective tissue disease, but the profile is negative because in mixed connective tissue disease, that autoantibody UNRNP is a must for you to call that label.
Any history of weight loss?
No history of weight loss.
Go ahead.
So, with history of 4 years of arthritis and acute onset edematous skin involving the hand and involvement of single peripheral nerve with raised ESR CRP and positivity of RA factor and DNA. So likely diagnosis again would be rheumatoid arthritis with overlap connective tissue disease or vasculitis, or infective causes, or rheumatoid arthritis along with infection. So we considered other etiology rather than rheumatoid arthritis and connective tissue disease. So points in favoring rheumatoid arthritis were she had 4 years of arthritis, and RF factor was positive, ANA was positive, they were high ESR and CRP, and on examination symmetrical synovitis was present. But point against to consider other etiology rather than RA and CTD, there is also involvement of single peripheral nerve and localized erythematous reaction over the hand, and pain in the distribution of the that involved single nerve, and there were no erosions. So we like to think of mononeuropathy with arthralgia involvement, infections like shingles, leprosy, Lyme's disease, diphtheria, HTLV and HIV, and vasculitis and malignancies will be other possibilities. We obtained a skin histopathological examination which showed papillary dermis, non-caseating epithelioid granulomas involving dermal appendages and erector pili, and there was inflammatory cells around the blood vessels which consisted of lymphocytes and foamy macrophages, which were suggestive of borderline lepromatous leprosy. So diagnosis of borderline lepromatous leprosy with peripheral nerve involvement and leprosy reaction was considered.
So I think here the question that always comes to our mind is that was it rheumatoid right label for the last 4 years? This only follow up will tell us. Because the clinical symptoms, though there was a rheumatoid arthritis and rheumatoid factor was positive, the neuropathy has not developed overnight because it was both axonal and demyelinating. Probably there could have been oversight of patient not complaining about it, or even the clinical examination might not have picked up. And patient was on a methotrexate stable dose for quite some time with minimal deformities. What made us to think about the alternative issue is because of the asymmetricity of the rash. Rash was not typically what we see in vasculitis. It was more on the dorsal aspect, less on the tips of the fingers, which you see more in vasculitis. In vasculitis, along with ulcers, usually you see those rashes and vasculitic changes more on the tips rather than on the proximal. So those made us to reconsider that the possible diagnosis could be something else. So that was the reason why we went ahead with biopsy. Biopsy showed the possible diagnosis. But the dilemma remains is that was this 4 year of a treatment of considering rheumatoid, was it a part and parcel of lepromatous leprosy? Because even in leprosy, non-specific rheumatoid factor is well described. It is seen approximately around 15% to 20% of leprosy patients to have rheumatoid factor positivity in higher titers.
So, anti-CCP
was not done because usually what we do is any rheumatologist or anybody who is practicing, once rheumatoid factor is positive and we clinically suspect it to be a rheumatoid arthritis, usually we don't go ahead with anti-CCP for the cost constraint. So you are at the diagnosis, now anti-CCP is not really required.
Question is, in lepromatous leprosy, will anti-CCP be positive in the presence of a...
Anti-CCP also can be positive.
Anti-CCP, ANA, RF factor, all three can be positive.
All three can be positive. So you can have all the antibodies in lepromatous leprosy and any leprosy.
So usually presentation like inflammatory arthritis is common in leprosy, and previous earlier studies were reported like Atkin et al. And even in Indian studies have reported the prevalence of arthritis like 61% in one study and 10% in one more study. And prevalence rate of arthritis were in the cohort of 1,257 patients of leprosy. Means they are 6.3% of patient had arthritis, that has also been reported. And pure neuritic kind of leprosy and spontaneously triggered leprosy reaction, they pose a unique diagnostic challenge when mimicking the rheumatic disease.
So Hansen, this is my show, various autoantibodies like ANA, anti-DSDNA, anti-caudalipin antibodies, anti-CCPA, and RF factor. And leprosy arthritis also may coexist with the rheumatoid arthritis, and that was reported in 21% of the patients in one of the studies. So this patient was initiated on rifampicin, dapsone and clofazimine combination, and with a short dose of short course of methylprednisolone, 36 mg per day, and she was advised to taper over 6 weeks, and she was called after 2 months on follow-up, where there was resolution of erythematous nephritic reaction and improvement in pain, and other blood parameters were settled. Thank you.
So I think we are still following it up, whether she still have a rheumatoid or not. Hopefully next update I will give the information about it. But I was seriously considering that it, the whole thing to be predominantly a lepromatous, leprosy, which was missing the exact treatment, because she was also previously in the follow-up with rheumatologist. The diagnosis was very much missing sometime. This is what we need to be careful. I think the first talk still remains the gospel truth. Connective tissue disease is a rare disease. Common diseases are still common. Though leprosy has been eradicated, still we need to think about it, especially if the patients are from borders of Andhra Pradesh, Gulbarga, Bijapur, and some part of Tumkur. There, leprosy still exists, and it's not that we are leprosy-free as we stand right now. So when these group patients or these area patients come, we still suspect leprosy. I think one of the reasons why I was still wondering about this patient for a leprosy was, I think she is somewhere from close to that Tumkur border, actually. I think Kolar-Tumkur border. She was from Kolar, yes. And that's one of the, yeah.
Been using methotrexate and steroid and all, wouldn't that infective element would have come earlier or presented earlier?
Yeah, it depends again. See, it depends on how good or how well the immune response has come. We were also surprised because it's almost for a 4-year patient was on methotrexate, hydroxychloroquine and intermittent steroids. And why never she flared except in this episode? So that's where we are still wondering that she might have been harboring a very subclinical leprosy that might have been worsened because of the management of rheumatoid, which could be coexisting. I think he presented one of the literature where they have almost reported 21% of overlap of rheumatoid plus leprosy. So she could be one case, she might have been having rheumatoid, might have been harboring leprosy in a very subclinical features. Methotrexate might have triggered it to come out firmly, and it's there was bacilli were in full in the entire tissue. That suggests that this patient has been adequately immune suppressed. So to have that much of streams of bacilli there.
In this case, would you like to consider BMRDs and other anti-rheumatic drugs were totally withdrawn?
Yeah, I think what we did was we withdrew the methotrexate, we withdrew the hydroxychloroquine. She was already on steroids, and we have slowly tapered down the steroids. And we have introduced the anti-leprosy 3-drug regime, and 2 months follow-up has been done, and I think we are waiting for her next follow-up. So we may reintroduce anti-rheumatic drug if those antibody persist and the symptom relapses. If symptom doesn't relapses, I think that concludes that probably it was only leprosy which was troubling her till now, which was missing us to be a rheumatoid. Yes. All mycobacteriums are prone to have this. Even the atypical myco can also come up like this.